granting you a 15-minute break. We're going to push lunch back about 15 minutes, so take the time, get your refreshments, and rest it up. Our next paper is being given by Dick Gonzales. It's the thermal stability of silica-supported premium catalysts prepared by the Sol-Gel method. Co-author is W. Zoe, and Dick Gonzales is currently the Herman and George R. Brown Professor of Chemical Engineering and Acting Head of the Department of Chemical Engineering at Tulane. He got his PhD at Johns Hopkins working for Dick Kokas. He's been at the University of Rhode Island, University of Chicago, where he learned he preferred research to administration, I hear. And now he's at Tulane University, and he is a veteran of many marathons, and he's known for his distance ability. And he's also currently president of the North American Catalysis Society, and would like all of us to attend the meeting in Snowbird, Utah.
Thank you, Rob. Let me try and get us back on schedule. I won't take 40 minutes. I'm very pleased to be here. As president, one of my goals is to visit all 13 clubs. This is my seventh. And in two more years, I think I may make it. I don't think I have to go back to Chicago since I know that club very well. It's too cold. I want to sort of follow up on what Bill was talking about this morning and on how to support metals on such things as silica and alumina, and to try and circumvent a major problem that occurs with highly dispersed metal catalysts on supports, and that is the question of thermal stability. How do we improve the thermal stability other than by adding such additives as barium oxide and various other ways that are currently in use? I'm going to talk about a particularly stubborn metal, and that is palladium. But before I talk about palladium, I'm going to tackle an easier problem, that of platinum on silica, to sort of acquaint you with the method. And those of you at Union Carbide who heard my talk about 6 months ago will have to dispense of a little bit of repetition here, but I think it's necessary. I must apologize. You see, I just got a new German Shepherd puppy, a high-tech puppy, and he was, you know, he's 90% German Shepherd and 10% Wolf. It's a $2,000 dog, but he got hold of my glasses before coming, and they keep on falling off. I tried to straighten them out in the air, but I just didn't have all that much. What I want to talk about then is first to try and discuss with you how we can stabilize platinum on silica. We've also done this on alumina, by the way. Now, in one of the previous talks, there was a nice, a very good reference, which is a landmark on the sintering of supported metal catalysts. And supported metals essentially sinter by three processes. One is simply the evaporation of metals. It's a high temperature process. The gas phase transport of volatile compounds such as chlorides. And a third, lower temperature mechanism, primarily the migration of crystallites through surface diffusion. And I got into this because Elie Ruckenstein came to visit me about 2 years ago, and he gave a nice talk. And he had reviewed one of my papers and was enthusiastic about it and gave me some suggestions. First, let's look at the migration or the sintering via surface diffusion. Let me try the pencil rather than the laser pointer. Surface diffusion is essentially directly proportional to the temperature and inversely proportional to something which, for lack of a better name, let's just call it a metal support interaction. It includes such things as the wetting angle of the crystallite on the support, the influence that the atmosphere has on the wetting angle, and also simply the interaction or the interfacial surface area, SI, between the metal and the support. But you can lump all of these things together and say this is just a metal support interaction. So if we decrease that metal support interaction, then surface diffusion via and the particle size differed by a factor of 2, then surface diffusion was dramatically decreased. And finally, if we could get a match between the pore diameter and the particle size without choking off the internal pore volume, then the surface diffusion would decrease to about 0. He did these through theoretical considerations, and he says, I think that because of what I hear that you're doing, you could check this out experimentally. So we decided, we attempted to do that. Now, catalysts, supported metal catalysts, have been prepared by a variety of methods, most of which involve impregnation and ion exchange. So our synthesis is a little bit different. We use the sol gel approach, in which we have a one-phase preparation. We start with a homogeneous solution, which includes the precursor support, and the reagent, which is water, which tends to form the gel, which then can be dried to give you the supported metal catalyst. And the synthesis is very simple. As precursors, we use several. We used platinum acetyl acetonate, the tetramine, the chloride, and as the silica precursor, we used primarily tetroxycycline. And the procedure then was to start out with the tetroxycylane and dilute it with a solvent, usually ethanol. Later we found that acetone was better. We heat this to 45 degrees. We mix in the precursor. The most useful was platinum acetyl acetonate at the desired metal loading, so we have a homogeneous solution. This was dissolved in acetone. We mix these two solutions together. This is just a Betty Crocker recipe, and then we just add the designed amount of water to trigger off the synthesis. And we did this in a rotavapor at various temperatures. 50 was about the most optimum. Now, one of the very significant variables which affects the pore size is the amount of water that you add to the tetroxycycline. What I have plotted here is the average pore diameter as a function of the water to tetroxycycline ratio. These numbers here refer to the amount of water that is mixed in with the tetroxycycline, and you can see in comparison with the ion exchange material that as you increase the designed amount of water, not only does the pore size decrease, but the distribution becomes considerably more narrow. So one of the differences between our work and that of Ed Coe is that nobody has ever worked with a water to tetroxy ratio as high as 60. So when you work at that ratio, you can see that you can really reduce the pore diameter to about 3.5 nanometers, 2 nanometers, but below that you get a micropore structure which becomes not very easy to handle. So there are other variables which affect the pore size distribution, pH, gelation temperature, but certainly the water to tetroxycycline ratio is by far the most significant variable. Now, I want you to notice another finding here, and that is as the pore size drops from 7.5 nanometers to 3.5 nanometers, this drop in the pore size acts as a template for the particle size. In other words, as this pore diameter drops, the average particle size increases. So from 1.7 nanometers, or about 17 angstroms, by dropping this pore diameter to about 3.5, we can approach a very nice match between the particle size and the average pore diameter, 3.2 as opposed to 3.5. Just a very brief word on the effect of the precursor. Here we tried three different precursors. They're chloroplatinic acid, tetramine nitrate, and the acetylacetonate. A problem, of course, is the question of the surface potential. We measured the zeta potential as a function of pH for the sol gel silica, and it's very much like silica. We have an isoelectric point at about 2. At a pH higher than 2, the surface is negatively charged, and at a pH lower than 2, then the surface is positively charged. Now, if you start out with chloroplatinic acid, you're sort of restricted to a low pH, and you're pretty close to the isoelectric point, so it's very hard to get very high dispersion in the chloroplatinic acid on silica. You get about 55 angstroms. On the other hand, at a pH of about 4, working with the tetramine nitrate, you're here, you have a negatively charged surface. This has a cationic speciation, which means that there's a strong metal support interaction, and the dispersion is too high. We would like dispersions to be around 55%, which sort of agrees with the size of the pore. And we found that the best precursor for that was the platinum acetylacetonate, which is not charged in solution, but is perhaps slightly polar, so that dispersions of, or particle sizes rather, as measured by both hydrogen chemisorption and TEM, to sort of agree and are around 20 angstroms. Okay. Now, let's just look at what happens when we treat these materials at a sintering temperature of around 600 degrees. First, I think it's always useful to start out by making a comparison with the ion exchange high dispersion material. What happens when you heat treat this at 650 degrees for 24 hours? The particle size increases by close to an order of magnitude, from about 1.8 nanometers to 11 nanometers. So you get a very rapid sintering. I must also point out that the sintering is also a function of the initial particle size. It will depend upon how big the particle is. Smaller particles sinter more rapidly than large particles. So we tried a sol gel preparation of relatively high metal loading, and we were somewhat discouraged. Let's see. Well, first we would expect sintering here, because in this case there was a very poor match between the average pore size and the particle size. This is 7.5 as opposed to 1.7. And treatment at 600 degrees for 24 hours resulted in a sintering which was nearly as great as that, was greater in fact than the ion exchange material. But now, if we match the particle size to the pore diameter, we were still sort of discouraged. Here we had a reasonably good match. We had a pore diameter of about 3.5, a particle size of about 3.3, 2.5 as measured by hydrogen chemisorption. The problem with hydrogen chemisorption is that the metal loading was, well, no, this is 1%, so the pulse method gave you a reasonably good measure of particle size. But sintering was still substantial, not as great, but still not useful. So the next step then was to try to stabilize this a little bit better by dropping the metal loading. And we dropped the metal loading to a little under 0.5%. And when we looked at these materials and looked at their sintering rate, we found that starting out with a sol gel catalyst in which there was a reasonably good match between the pore size and the particle size, that the heat treatment at 675 degrees for up to 72 hours resulted in a much higher thermal stability, and these materials were quite resistant to sintering. Okay. Now the question is, we have succeeded in doing this. Are these good catalysts? Are we blocking off the pores? Are we restricting the diffusion into the porous volume of the catalyst? So we ran a typical reforming reaction, the conversion of normal hexane instead of normal heptane, and as measured by the rate of disappearance of the normal hexane, the zero gel, which is the sol gel preparation, gave a turnover frequency which was quite similar to the ion exchange material, within 10 or 20%. There was very little difference. This difference is probably within experimental limits of the measurements. And any changes in the turnover frequency were simply related to particle size. So these catalysts were not being obstructed by the metal. They were thermally resistant. Not only that, but they didn't deactivate any more rapidly than the ion exchange material. Here we have, after about 6 to 8 hours on stream, the rate of n-hexane conversion had decreased by maybe 15%. I should say something about the zero gel. There are two ways of getting rid of the solvent. One is to add excess solvent and evacuate under supercritical conditions. If you do this, you get the aerogel. If you evacuate this and an oven, you get a zero gel. The aerogel has a more open structure, a higher surface area. But these surface areas are close to 800 square meters per gram, a very high surface area materials. Okay. Now, I also measured the first order deactivation rate constant, and you can see for the ion exchange materials, it's very similar to the zero gel with an experimental error. The deactivation is not that different from our catalyst compared to the ion exchange materials. Well, with that background, we decided to tackle a more troublesome, a more difficult metal, and that is palladium. Palladium, we have been talking about converting the automotive converters to palladium-only catalysts, moving the catalyst, the converter, closer to the manifold, which will lead to large excursions of temperature. Therefore, there is a demand for increasingly thermally resistant materials. Now, palladium turned out to be a little more difficult, but the graduate student that was working on this was very tough, and he stayed with it. You know, it's a question of matching up the pore size to the particle size. That's very good. Whenever you feel down, remember this: you've got to stay with it. Right? So we went to this palladium business.
Which will segue